In this video, we'll show how to diagnose and replace a noisy fan in an oven. We'll demonstrate the function of a shaded pole inductive motor, and we'll go into the detail as to how it works and why this little motor is the most common AC motor in a home. Good morning, guys. Well, I find it hard to believe that it's been 5 years since I put that first video on YouTube showing how to diagnose and replace the thermal shutdown fuses in this Kitchenaid Superba oven. Since then, the oven has been doing fine, and this is the oven here today. In the last 6 weeks, we've noticed a loud noise coming from where I think the fan is in the top part of the oven, and of somewhat more concern is the fact that intermittently, a few times, we've actually had a power shutdown where we get a PF message, power failure. But in contrast with the thermal fuses, I'm able to restart the oven a few hours later, and so it's a transient thing, and I'm not sure what to make of that. Now, for those of you who are doing this the first time, if you want more specific instruction as to how to get to the stage that we're at now, or more details about how to tear things apart, go to that other video that I did. I'll put a link to it in the description. And right now, let's turn the oven on and see what we come out with. Now, I should mention that if you're going to do this, make sure that you have two people to take that oven out, because it's really heavy and you don't want it to fall. And then secondly, make sure the power is off when you remove the oven. So I've got the power back on because we need to have power live to be able to do this testing. Okay, this is AC power that's here. And you can see we're 118 volts of AC power that's getting to the motor. You can see it's trying to turn it, but just doesn't want to do it. There's some resistance there. Now, just for kicks, I'm measuring current draw. It looks like we're not drawing much current at all here, 0.2 amps. Okay, I've turned the power off again, so now I'm going to just take these little spade connectors. It's wise to remember which wire went to which, but realistically speaking, it is AC current, so it probably doesn't make much difference. 25.7 ohms. Now, the manual, as I recall, says about 10 to 18 ohms. I'll double check that and put that number in the video here, but our resistance is too high and our current is too low, and clearly the fan is not spinning, so this part is bad and we can't fix it from here, and so we need to take it off. Now, it's easy enough to take off. There are four screws that hold it on, two on each side, and we just unscrew those and remove the device, so I'll do that now. Well, you can imagine that air management is a huge engineering challenge. Cool air is drawn past the sensitive electronics to the blower, then pushed down and out. I've been calling this part here the snorkel. It's not quite as shown. Hot air inside the oven is given a passageway to escape. It gets to a T intersection here and then is drawn either through to the blower or it goes directly out through the exhaust air. When the oven is on, you should be able to see it coming out here. So here's the old part and the new part, and they look pretty much identical. I'll have to swap over this snorkel and that'll be no problem. The new part does come with some brackets you can use if you need them. Now, when I was initially working this up, I was wondering whether I could get by with just replacing the shielded pole motor rather than replacing the whole fan apparatus. And initially my impression was that the bearings were fine, but listen to this. And then compare it to the new one. The new one is silky smooth. Now, these are low torque mortars, so that slight difference may be enough to cause problems. And so in retrospect, I'm not unhappy that I got the whole thing.
In case you need them, these are the markings on the new shielded pole motor. The old motor had no markings at all.
This is interesting. I've got it set at ohms. We're measuring simple resistance. And as with the old part, the resistance varies as I rotate. But what's interesting here is the new part is outside of the normal range for the factory specs. So they've obviously changed the manufacturing criteria. Now let's check current draw on the new device. .44 amps. I must say my initial impression was that the shielded pole motor was bad and that the bearings were good. But now, after having had a chance to compare the new with the old motor and the new bearings with the old bearings, I think that this is a bearing problem. And I think the shielded pole motor is good. Okay, I've got it partially hooked up just to make sure it all works. We're going to put the convection fan on. Mm-hmm. there are four shaded pole motors in this oven. This one is the one we replaced. It's a lot quieter. This is the convection fan. And there's a second fan down here. And then another convection fan at the bottom. And it looks like they're all working. This one is a little bit on the noisy side, but I'm not seeing any big issue there. I might put a few drops of oil onto it. And then inside, you can see the convection fan is working. Is funner a word? There's nothing funner than the autopsy phase of a repair. And I'm looking forward to this one in particular because we get to take apart this shaded pole motor. You'll find these shaded pole motors everywhere in your house. You probably have 10 of them. And so one of these days you're gonna have to fix it. You may as well learn a little bit about how they work. These things are really intriguing. I find these motors to be elegantly simple. I'm gonna tear this one down a little bit. I'm gonna show you the basic parts and then I'm gonna explain to you how it all works. So this is the shaded pole motor here, and AC current comes in here and goes to a single coil. What I find most interesting about this motor is that there's no start windings, there's no start capacitor, it's very simple. This is the laminate core right here, it's an iron core that helps to propagate the magnetic field. And when the motor spins in this direction, and this is the way it actually spins normally, then it rotates the little squirrel cage down there. You can actually see it moving. You'll get a better look at it in a minute. Now the thing that defines this is a shaded pole motor. The way to recognize shaded pole motors is to recognize the two shaded poles. Here's one right here, and then there's a second one right over here. And the shaded pole is simply a winding of copper. It can be one, in this case it's two loops, and in this case it's a figure of eight that's wrapped around the laminate core. Let's tear it down and look at it a little more closely. It looks like it's mounted here on this end, so I'm going to rotate this housing off and get a closer look. There we are. Well, dang, I forgot to record it, but all I did was I just pulled it straight off and it just came undone. Now listen to this as I spin. You can feel those bearings are just really not wanting to spin they're not very friendly at all. Let's put power to it now and see if it spins. Nothing. Here's a little closer view. Here's one shaded pole, and there's the other one. And it's just a loop of wire. In this case, it's a figure of eight going around the laminate core, but really just two loops, one on each side, and they're not attached to anything. What's the point of that? Now I'll tell you something else that's interesting. When you look at this orientation with the one shaded pole here and the other one there, when you apply current to this, this will rotate counterclockwise. And it'll be the same even if you change the orientation of the wires. You can't change that. When it's mounted like this, you get counterclockwise rotation. So the way around that, if you need clockwise rotation, you take this whole device and you flip it upside down so the shaded pole is here and here, and if you do that, then you'll get clockwise rotation of your drum. Isn't that interesting? Now I'd like to take this off a little bit further so I can get the rotor out. I'm going to undo these two bolts here and pull this part off. Now look at these witness marks here. There's a lot of abrasion on the outside part of the drum. Clearly the brass bushings that support the axis wore down to the point that the drum was able to shift to one side. Let's have another look at the rotor. Now these rotors are interesting. They have metal bars, either iron or copper or sometimes aluminum, and they go lengthwise in a diagonal, and they conduct electricity. And when the electricity gets to the end cap right here, it equalizes and then comes back on the opposite angle. And it's that electricity that generates its own magnetic field, which in turn is pushed by the magnetic field of the primary coil. And so that's the way this thing turns. An inductive motor creates currents in the rotor, and those currents set up a countermagnetic field. And that's that, the two magnetic fields, as they interact, they spin the rotor. Fascinating. Let's start with some anatomy. This motor is called a two-pole motor, and I'm circling one pole in yellow and one pole in green. You can see the thick copper wires that make up the shaded poles. There's one on each pole, and they're placed in diagonally opposite positions. Those wires need to be thick because they get really hot with current and they need to be durable. Now let's look carefully at the pole at the top of this photo. These motors are called split pole motors because each pole is made up of an unshaded side, I'm marking that with yellow, and a smaller shaded side near the copper loops, labeled in green. Now here's a convenient rule of thumb. First you have to identify one pole, and then identify within that one pole the shaded part and the unshaded part. The rotation of the rotor will always be from the unshaded side to the shaded side, shown by the blue arrow. Now let's look at how it works. Here's a motor without shaded poles. The rotor is mounted inside the circle and you're looking right down its rotational axis. As this design stands, you'll get a flipping magnetic field. At one instant, north will be at the top, and 1/120th of a second later, it will be at the bottom. What was needed was an asymmetry, a way to create a rotating magnetic field so that the rotor has a bias as to which direction to follow. The genius solution was to add in these two offset loops of wire. The math is complicated, but effectively the induced magnetic field from the loops distorts the magnetic field in such a way that the rotor sees magnetic rotation with time. It's not perfect uniform, but it provides enough torque to get the rotor moving. The induced magnetic field in the rotor causes it to chase the rotation like a dog chasing the tires of a car. Interestingly, if you do the math, you'll see the induced current in the rotor is related to how far behind the magnetic field it is. So if the rotor completely catches up to the rotation of the field, it loses acceleration. This means that the rotor will find a steady state, slightly behind the natural rotation of the field, where friction balances torque. With household AC current, the natural rotation is 3600 RPM, and these rotors typically spin at around 3500. Well, what if you need more exacting rotation? Then instead of relying on induced current in a squirrel cage, you put a permanent magnet inside the rotor. That design is called a synchronous shaded pole motor, used in clocks and turntables, etc. So there you have it. Now that you've seen how these work, I think you can understand why these little motors are inexpensive, self-starting, and durable. You saw that even when seized, they don't tend to draw much power, so they're not so prone to the drastic overheating found with other designs. Now on the downside, you'll never find a shaded pole motor used in high torque applications like a drill or a lift. They clearly occupy that low power, low torque niche. But even now, a century after invention, this design is still a winner. Say, if this video helped you out and you want to see more of them, then hit like or subscribe or leave a comment. I'd love to hear what others say, and it makes it easier for others to find. Thanks for watching.